stuff that you're doing, and this is not what this is about, but just so people know that you got some new stuff cooking, and now you're here with us to play Diablo 2.
Yeah, sounds
That's
good.
freaking great. So you have the game running as well, right?
I thought I did, but it didn't seem to actually work. I don't know what happened here. It crashed. It was not happy. So I haven't gone into technically debugging it yet.
Okay, well, if anyone knows how to fix it, it's you. So I guess that's my first question. Let's start there. So here we are. When was Diablo 2 released? 99? 2000?
I think that it was June 2000.
Okay.
I'm pretty sure that it was somewhere right in there.
So we are greater than 15 years since the release of Diablo 2. And I know that when your head's down working on anything, you're probably not thinking 15 years down the road. But how does it feel to still be coming back to this game that you're so well known for?
Well, I mean, it's a pleasure to be known for something like that. It's amazing. It's incredible that that people still play this game a lot. And I still hear comments and stories all the time about people playing even recently and whatnot. And it's just very flattering. And I'm so blessed to have been part of such an amazing experience.
So how big was the Diablo 2 team overall?
Well, it varied in size. When it started out, when we started out making Diablo 2, we were probably around 25 to 30 people, somewhere right in there, when we started working on Diablo 2. And by the time it was done, we were in the 60s. But that's just up at north. And then we shared resources with the guys down south at the Blizzard headquarters, and they had QA some QA support down there, and they had marketing and PR and the forum moderators and customer service and all the things that, so a lot more people worked on it. And they had cinematics, so there were a lot of people that worked on the product that weren't actually in the that weren't actually in the in up north.
Gotcha. Yeah, so it varied over time. And just relatively, what about the Diablo 1 team?
Diablo One team, I mean, it was the same sort of situation that we shared resources with down south, but the team started out, small, around 10 or so, and then around the end, it got into the low 20s, I think.
Gotcha. So Diablo 2 came in bigger, better, a lot more that you guys can do because of the success of Diablo 1. You probably got some more of your ideas to come to light. And then there was Battle.net, which was a huge
Also, yeah, it
success.
was the technical challenges that we made Battle.net for Diablo One. But it was, in its infancy at that point, and it was peer-to-peer for the most part. It wasn't client-server, so that meant that we had there was rampant cheating and whatnot. So we wanted to clear that up with Diablo 2, and that meant more resources, more programming resources, and being able to do that client-server architecture and have the entire infrastructure and able to, withstand the amount of people that are going to be playing.
Right. So something that my friend and I were talking about the other day when I was telling him I'm doing the stream with you, I asked him, what questions would you ask David? And something that he was curious about is back when you were making Diablo 2, so late 90s and really early in 2000, the internet was really 56K modems, right? That's what
Oh, yeah.
consumers were using. Did you and your team, did your ideas get hampered or constrained by modem speeds, or did you just know what you were working with and you kind of built out the infrastructure based on that, and all of your ideas didn't get held back because of it?
No, I mean, actually, it doesn't really matter that much. I mean, it's a little different today, and you can do more stuff, but the amount of information that you need to pass between the different computers to communicate what's going on is small. There's not much information needs to go back and forth. You know, to do patches and things like that, which require many megabytes, you know, that really helps to have a faster connection. But we weren't doing a lot of patches and whatnot. So it was having the amount of communication that we needed between them was minimal.
Gotcha.
And so that wasn't really a concern. It wasn't really a blockade. The bigger thing really wasn't the amount of bandwidth between the different the client and the server or whatever you had. If you had a 56K modem or whatever, it was more that the latency, because the amount of time it took for you to get that information to the server and get it back, a lot can change. When you're making a client-server game, the server decides everything. So this way, you can't have cheating, right? Mm-hmm. It decides what kind of loot you're going to have, how much experience you gain, all of these kind of things. And so when it's making these decisions, you have to kind of simulate what you think the answer might be on the client, and then get it confirmed by the server. And so that the amount of time between there is how long you have to kind of fake your way and to make it look good for a little while until you get the real information from the server. So that was much more of a challenge than anything else. And trying to code around the latency or having large latency, it's always been a challenge and continues to be a challenge even today, because you get into, you know, foreign countries with large latencies when they're out in, you know, in more rural areas, things like that. And it's still a problem to try and mask that as best you can. It's not so much of a problem when you're in a major city or something, like living here in San Francisco. There's almost no latency to anything, so it's not really that big of a deal. But you have to plan for the worst, not plan for the best.
That makes sense. Now, fortunately, Diablo 2 could also be an offline experience. You know, massive single-player campaign, tremendous amount of replayability. It almost, you know, every character is almost completely different, because all the different options and configurations, permutations, there's so much depth. And then the expansion set came out, Lore of Destruction, which is what we have open now, and that brought a couple new characters, right? The Necromancer, wasn't that part of the expansion set?
Or was it the Monk? Druid and Assassin were
That's right. Okay. That's right. Perfect. Well, do you have the game open and running? Are you ready to start?
No, I don't. I couldn't get it running. I'm sorry.
Oh, no worries.
It's not functioning. I'm not really sure why.
So, no problem. Well, why don't we create a new character?
Technical difficulties getting it started, and it continues to this moment.
That's right. So I was having a bunch of technical difficulties. You were having some too. But as soon as I got mine to work, I just yelled, "Okay, let's go. We're going to start. We're going live right now." So we do apologize for being late, everybody. So we do have some questions coming in through the stream. This is from Pride of a Viking. Oh, that's an interesting question. He said he'd like to know if the unpublished project from Diablo 3 that is on YouTube is real, or it's just a hoax.
I don't know what that is.
Yeah, can you link that to us, Pride of a Viking?
Yeah, if he links it, maybe I'll take a look at it. I mean, I remember what our Diablo 3 looked like, but I don't, you know, I don't know.
Well, what kind of character do you want to start with here, David? We've got the Amazon, Assassin.
It's up to you. I mean, I think that they're all fun, so I don't, you know, I have no preferences. The Necromancer is kind of hot right now because of the fact that they're going to put the Necromancer in Diablo 3, you know, and it's harken back to the Diablo 2 thing, but you would think.
All right, that makes sense. Let's go with that. So we'll name it Playing with David. I never thought in my wildest imagination I'd ever be playing this game. Oh my gosh, with you. This is awesome. And he did link it. So yeah, we'll take a look at that. Thanks a lot, Private Viking. All right, let's make sure my audio here. I'm going to just drop the sound so that it's not overwhelming the people in the audience. All right, so I know you can't see this, David, but if you log into the Twitch stream, at least you can kind of see it.
I do have the Twitch stream up. So
Perfect. So... what I used to do in Diablo 1 is I would just start by selling my club, and I'd go in bare fist because that money was so important at the beginning of the game. But that's not what I'm doing right now. So, all right, I'm in the blood more. So when you started the game, now the way I feel about Diablo 1, and I'll be talking about Diablo 1 a lot, just FYI, it's my favorite game of all time. And I mean, my gosh, I played so much of it, and I remember... a spring break in junior high school where I just took the whole week off and played Diablo 1. It was, and I, you know what? I don't even think I was playing the full game. I think I was on that demo where you can play the first four levels of the cathedral. And I just played it over and over again. But something that I learned once I got the full game is there were no difficulty settings. I felt like the character classes were the difficulty setting. Between the warrior, the rogue, and the sorcerer. Was that intentional in Diablo 1?
No, the game was, Diablo 1 was a pretty difficult game. So I think that the characters we didn't have the best balance of all time, but again, it was really the first RPG that we had made, and so we were kind of learning better what to do and what not to do. Diablo 2, I think, was better balanced than Diablo 1.
Diablo 2, it's certainly well balanced, no doubt there. I mean, how do you balance a game? Because did you have all the characters in mind from the beginning, not counting the expansion characters?
Yeah, we did. We started out with a couple different ones, but we had kind of the ideas for a bunch of them early, and fleshed them out one at a time. I think the first character that we worked on was the Amazon. I believe that was the first one that we worked on, but I can't remember exactly.
So you're not only balancing against the other bad guys, but you're also balancing against, for multiplayer.
Yeah, absolutely. It was it's both. And we tried to make it, feel and play differently depending on, what class you're playing. And that was really the most important thing to us. Not necessarily that one class was more powerful than the other, mm-hmm. but that wasn't really the way we started out. But by the end, we really want to try and balance them as closely as possible in play and difficulty as we could. And that really just comes with iteration. It comes with playing over and over and over again and finely tuning and slightly adjusting numbers. There was a lot of play time, a lot of hours put in by the dev team to ensure that the balance was as good as it could be.
So with a game like this, seven characters by the time the expansion came out, but then, I imagine behind the scenes with the balancing is sort of a massive spreadsheet in back of my mind. So then in terms of scale,
it actually is a spreadsheet that was in Excel.
Like literally in Excel.
Literally in Excel. We had our tools exported the Excel, converted the Excel spreadsheet data into text, and then we imported the text, and it was tab delineated text that we parsed.
Awesome.
And that's how we created our data. It was actually from the spreadsheet.
Well, so it's not just accountants that live on Excel, it's also devs, apparently. Man, that Microsoft, they know what they're doing.
Excel was one of the greatest game dev tools of all
time. That's interesting because, seven characters, that's a lot of logic that goes into balancing them, but you just got off of Marvel Heroes after a few years, and there's 30 or more characters in Marvel Heroes. Is it the same logic? You just created a sense of scalability once you figured out the levers of complexity between each character and how they're related?
Yeah, when you try and create, it's not perfect and it's not that easy because you come up with kind of exceptions to rules to make things interesting. And so, you have kind of a baseline of what you're shooting for, but sometimes and a lot of times your powers and your kind of, you'll have base numbers where you expect things to be at specific times. In your experience of leveling up or whatever. Mm-hmm. And you're going to say, okay, it's going to take this amount of time to do this much damage, and so therefore I'm going to, do this much damage. But it's almost impossible to really balance, especially in an action RPG, to do it extremely well because it's hard to do things like compare, I'm going to hit a bunch of things with I'm going to hit one thing, because then you aren't always hitting a bunch of things. And when you are hitting a bunch of things, are you hitting two things, three things, five things, eight things, mm-hmm. And the amount of damage that you're doing is different. So like balancing that all out just comes with the actual playing experience and kind of saying, oh, usually I'm fighting two or three things at a time or whatever, rather than, you know, 25, though it does blossom to that. And then I have got some stuff for bosses that, you know, does this, that, and the other thing. And so all those numbers kind of are built off of a chart that where you expect to be at the specific level. And so it's a modifier on that, those kind of baseline numbers.
So we did have a question from the Twitch community the other day. Sure. Who's your favorite boss in Diablo 2?
My favorite boss in Diablo 2? Well, I mean, it's kind of cheaty, but I are they talking about, you know, unique, or are we talking about, because Diablo is my favorite, but it's, you know, that's kind of a wimp out answer.
Well, they didn't specify, so I guess who's your second favorite?
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I think that there's a lot of the bosses, especially the unique monsters and whatnot, that have a lot of flavor, and so you know, they have randomly generated names and whatnot too. So it's not always the same character. So anyway, it's I think that. You know, I'm just going to stick with Diablo. I think that's my favorite.
So what is it about Diablo that makes him your favorite?
You know, it's the name of the game for a reason. Yeah. I mean, I think that, you know, it's... I think that he is the, you know, the point of the game. And so beating him is ultimately the most satisfying part of the game. Mm-hmm. Or then, so then, even like, you know, Andariel here in Act 1 or anything like that, that's, you know, doing the different... end bosses is fun, but the, you know, to be the victor, it is, you know, it's not just his moveset or anything like that. It's more that he is, you know, you feel like you are the hero when you finally defeat him.
Yeah, agreed. And that cutscene at the end of Diablo 1 with the Soul Stone, oh my gosh, it's so freaking powerful.
I remember the first time I saw that. Didn't even believe that they had done that. They didn't tell us they were going to do that, like the cinematic group or whatever down south. And then they showed it to us, and I was like, what the hell have they done? This is the total disaster. And I was really upset about it. And then I thought about it, and I was like, you know, actually, that's kind of cool. It's kind of weird and whatnot, but yeah, we're going to go with it. So it kind of grew on me over a course of a couple days, but the first time I saw it, my reaction was like, oh my God, what have we done here? What have we got ourselves into? And there's no going back. Anyway.
It was, right.
But in the end, I was like, realized, hey, this actually is a great ending.
Well, are there any other things that South did or anyone else in the team that didn't have, you know, for responsibilities that you didn't have? Were there people or groups that did things that just you didn't like but then eventually loved?
I don't know. I think cinematics is probably the team that we had least influence on. Everything else was pretty much under our control because we did everything here. Mm-hmm. So the cinematics, we would talk about, we would present ideas. They would say no. Then they would do whatever the hell they wanted. And then we would kind of review it with them and make some tweaks and suggestions and whatnot. But for the most part, they were able to kind of tell the story that they wanted to tell. It all fell within the, you know, they worked with the story team and whatnot, and it all fell within the realm of working together. But for the most part, they directed their cinematics and their, and pretty much did what they wanted, which, you know, in hindsight is the correct way to actually manage them, is get them interested in what they want to do the most, right, and make sure that, you know, you're going to get the best quality. Right. That said, you know, we were freaking out that other people were doing stuff in the Diablo universe without us,
right,
know, being intimately involved.
Right.
But we just couldn't. We didn't have the team. We didn't have the resources. It didn't make any sense to make two cinematic groups. Like, it just, like, it was the way it is, and we had to learn to just let go, and it was fine.
So your time at Gazillion working on Marvel Heroes, it must have been a different experience, right? Because as a CEO, you had authority or governance over the entire project team.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. You know, I mean, we did and we didn't. Again, we don't have... Ultimately, there are things that we did even on that project that was like, you know, there were outside resources that we would use for whatever. Let's say the putting together the motion comics, and you know, we don't have ultimate control over this particular artist. We would hire this particular Marvel artist to do the art for this thing, and if he drew something we didn't like, or you know, couldn't really use very well, it was we're kind of up the creek. That was the so you know, it wasn't all, you don't have perfect control over the creation of your game, as much as people would like to think that, unless you do every single aspect by yourself. There really isn't, and it's okay. You know, that's why it's a group effort, and that's why it's important to learn to let go at the beginning that you're not going to be able to control everything.
Makes sense. We missed a couple of questions in here. I'm not sure if you've been able to track these. Let me go back through DL. I want to find one here.
Alan Drosen said that his girlfriend likes my No-Nomancer game. I'm glad.
You're very flattered. Yeah. Awesome. Okay, so let's see. Oh, I better pay attention to the game. Hang on. I almost got killed by that gargantuan. Who invented the Fallen, by the way? Because it really bugs me that they run away.
I don't remember exactly who invented the Fallen. I mean, the Fallen were... It's not the Fallen were... So we had a rule, I had a rule at that applied to the entire team, is that every monster had to have its thing, whatever it is. One of the monsters in Diablo 1 was this creature that ran away as well, and so we thought that gameplay was pretty interesting, we're going to make these little shy guys. It also helped putting them at the beginning of the game because people weren't overwhelmed, right? You know, like having all of these characters come at you and fight you without having some relief where they're just pounding on you felt a little bit harsh at the very, very beginning, the very first time you're ever going to play. So having the guys kind of fall away was a decent mechanic at the beginning to kind of allow people to take a breather and not get beat on so badly before they really know what they're doing.
Yeah, that makes sense.
So that was their one thing. Their one thing is they're going to run away. So every monster had some kind of mechanic or move or something different about them that makes them interesting and different to encounter. And some of those combinations of those things working with other monsters makes for interesting, when they come across each other, they come with you know, their abilities play into each other and create interesting mechanics for you to experience.
Still drove me absolutely nuts, by the way.
Oh yeah, no, absolutely. They were the biggest pain in the ass in the whole series.
That's right. All right, I got some more questions. This is another one from Pride of a Viking. Since there are a lot of people playing Diablo 2, mainly on ladder resets, do you think Blizzard should improve more things, like the max resolution, you know, increasing that, or new and balanced rune words?
You know, what they do, it's amazing that they do anything. Didn't they just have a patch or something recently with Diablo 2 to fix some compatibility problems and BattleNet problems or whatever that people were having? So yeah. The fact is that it's a 16-year-old game. I think that people would love for it to be updated and kind of redone as a, you know, high-def version of this.
Yeah.
You know, but the problem with doing a high-def version of this is, first off, I don't even know if half these assets even exist anymore. You know, the original models don't look very good because they didn't need to look very good because they were kind of low res. There was, you know, they didn't need a lot of detail. Your imagination filled in a lot of the detail. If you looked at one of these things now compared to the way that high res stuff looks now, it looks terrible, right? You know, because they were just rendered to sprites in an 800 by 600. When Lord of Destruction came out, it was originally 640x480, but then 800, 600 reds, you know, they were just giant blurry pixels. So doing a high, you know, high def version, I think that people are excited about that kind of concept in theory, but I think that in practice, it's something that's very difficult to do because once you go back and you put in the assets and whatnot, how much of it do you change? Oh, I can't believe they didn't change this. You know, put in some new rune words or whatever. And then what happens if those rune words are the only rune words to get? And then the rune word game is kind of, you know, lame. You know, what happens if, oh, let's get rid of, I don't know, the stamina bar or something. Like, where do you stop? Where do you change? What do you change and not change? Oh, we're just going to change this little thing, and we're going to balance this skill a little better, you know, and it's just kind of a dangerous road to go down. And I feel like that they, you know, there are some games, like they're redoing Final Fantasy VII, for instance, or whatever, high def version. And my guess is they're going to end up changing a lot of the game, and then you're kind of defeating the point of exactly what you're trying to make again. So, you know, it's tough to imagine they're going to do anything. The only thing I could imagine is maybe they would do higher res, but higher res is not going to be easy because the assets are just so low res.
Right. And then if you get into the, it's just a never-ending cycle, to your point.
Right.
Yeah, yeah, it can be.
If they go with a higher res and you can see more of the screen and it's not 800, 600, let's say it's 1024, 768 or something like that, which is higher res, but it's still not even close to as higher res as we're used to these days. And in fact, it's not even, you know, a rectangle, you know, the kind of 16 by 9 or 16 by 10 kind of format that we're used to. Well, then, you know, you're going to see more of the outside of the world. And what happens if some of the graphics don't actually go outside, you know, it leaves like black holes around the outside edge? Because we actually... the amount of stuff that we're drawing and the size of the world actually was based on the screen resolution, you know, so that there are technical issues that will come up if they make the resolution higher.
But how does it make you feel that there's still so many people playing and so many people that want to see enhancements and improvements that don't change the nature? Yeah, I imagine. Yeah,
it's a complete blessing, and it's, you know, it's incredible. I'm so fortunate to have that as experience or whatever, and it's very flattering.
Yeah. Do you feel like you have other, you know, this is what you're known for?
The audio, in-game audio, is a little loud. I don't know if you turned it down or not.
You know, I had turned it down. Actually, I can turn it. I had the music still running a little bit in the background. Turn it completely off. Yeah, I'm having a little trouble, guys. I apologize. Mixing the sounds, the different sound sources, so apologize for that.
I think that there is a, like, in the menu, you can turn it down.
And that's what I ended up doing. I had it at the lowest setting, and it was still too loud for me. I couldn't even hear you.
Oh, okay. Okay.
When I was testing with my buddy, so, yeah. Sorry about that, guys.
I just want to make sure that they're
yeah, they, yeah, make sure it's enjoyable, for sure.
I was giving feedback. I don't know if that was right or not.
Yeah, yeah, no worries. So let's see. Here's a question from Viomaster, big Sony Vio fan. So if they made a Diablo 4, David, do you believe they would attempt to recapture the gameplay of Diablo 2 and 1 or stick with Diablo 3's arcadey style?
Yeah, I have no idea what they're going to do. You know, if they're going to make a Diablo 4 or what style they're going to go with. You know, I have no real influence on the series anymore. And so I would suspect that they're going to continue kind of the way that they had. I mean, the Diablo 3, there are a lot of people that enjoy that style and, you know, and have enjoyed Diablo 3. And despite the fact that maybe Diablo 3 wasn't, you know, what people wanted at the beginning, the game has really turned around and people are enjoying it a lot now. And they feel like it's in a much better spot after the expansion. And they feel like, you know, it's a really good game at this point. So I imagine that they're going to continue along the kind of same path that they've started with the changes that they made in Diablo 3. And they've kind of learned some lessons and have got a better grasp on where they want to go with the series.
So we got a ping from our friend Leo Wild. He's on.
Hey, Leo.
Good friend.
Yes.
Let's see, who else? Another question from L.A. Hondrason. Is there anything about D2's game systems that you don't like?
Well, yeah, but... but, I mean, for the most part, a lot of the system stuff I do like. I really like the skills trees, even though some people don't like them. And, And I really like, you know, there's no system that's perfect. I really like gems. I really like the rune words. I really like kind of the variety of builds that people make. I like the potion bar and only having a couple skills. And it seems old fashioned now that that, you know, because now people will put, you know, 8 abilities on a bar and stuff like that, make it much more fast paced and crazier. But I still really enjoy the pace of Diablo 2, and even though it's kind of a simpler game than typical action RPGs these days. So there are some stuff I don't like I don't really like the stamina bar almost at all. I don't know if I would make that same decision today that I made then. Mm-hmm. I understand why we did it. I mean, we just didn't want people running all the time. But in hindsight, you know, who cares?
Let them run, you know. Yeah. All right, cool. Storyline of the Marvel gameplay. All right, let me just read this one here. This is another one from Vile Master. Oh, they're coming in hot. David, do you think you might make a game similar to Diablo's gothic, powerful storyline with powerful gameplay mechanics like any other ARPG in the future? So do you have another ARPG in your future is the question.
Oh, I absolutely. At some point, we'll make another ARPG. I think that, you know, the projects that I'm working on right now by myself wouldn't qualify as an action RPG like mm-hmm. this. I mean, it's funny. Action RPG is the definition has changed. Some people think action RPG is Diablo, and some people think action RPG is like a real-time role-playing game, you know, so it's, you know, it's instead of a turn-based one or,
right.
you know, whatever, it's kind of action-oriented. And so, you know, I'm making RPGs still, but they're not like Diablo. They're different than that. But I imagine that I will go back and make a Diablo-like game, or maybe even someday, you know, work on Diablo again.
Yeah, you never know. Yeah.
You know, that. But that there is no plans in the future. I mean, in the near future to do that. But, you know, I'm still young enough that I'm going to be making games for a while. So
very young man. Very young
I
man.
Don't say that. I'm pretty old. But the but I have at least another 15, 20 years of making games. So. Plenty of time.
I've got another 15 years of playing them, so keep it coming. We've got a question from The Eradicator. David, what are your thoughts on Path of Exile as a spiritual successor to D2, and what is your involvement? I don't know if there's any. Let's find out.
Yeah. Well, I like Diablo. I mean, Path of Exile. I do think that in some ways it is a spiritual successor to Diablo 2. You know, it's the same kind of, you know, it's got a much closer atmosphere than many other action RPGs. And it's kind of dark and scary and creepy. And those guys are I know them well. The Grinding Gear Games guys. And in fact, I have I am now the official spokesperson for their I don't remember the exact word they use, but consultant on Path of Exile to help
really?
Them, especially with their China launch and doing a bunch of advice and feedback and whatnot with them for the their launch in China coming up soon.
I have to re-download it now. Now that I know you're part of it in some way, I got to re-download it. Maybe that'll be our next stream, is a stream of Path of Exile. That could be fun.
Sounds good.
Yeah, I put a lot of time into that. It was a heck of a lot of fun and free to play. You know, that's really
yep.
great. I think all the only ways to spend money are in-game cosmetic items, right?
Correct. Yeah, I believe that's correct. You know, they don't have the same kind of boosts and stuff that we had with Marvel Heroes.
Mm-hmm. Man, that Marvel Heroes is still going strong.
Yep.
Yeah, that was a lot of fun. Like 3,000 hours in that game. all right. So another one from Biomaster. I'm in love with everything you mentioned, David, because it all contributes to the feel of the game and pace. So that's a little bit of feedback from Biomaster. Pride of a King. Everyone calls you Brevik. I feel bad calling you Brevik. David.
No, everybody does call me Brevik. I don't mind at all.
It's fine.
They have no... I mean, David's kind of a generic name, so that, you know, it's a lot easier to call me Brevik. I don't know what... People have always done that. Even when I was a kid, people would call me Brevik.
No kidding. All right. I'm the only one trying to be proper here.
It's kind of catchy, maybe. I don't know.
It's catchy. All right. Well, Brevik, question for you here. So
I miss B a lot on Twitch and on, you know, on the streams and stuff that we do. They call me Mr. B a lot.
Mr. B. All right. So Brevik, would you like to see a Diablo 2 movie, just like the WoW movie that was recently released?
I'd love to see I don't know about Diablo 2 specifically, but just a Diablo movie in general, I would love to see one. Yeah, yeah. That would be amazing.
That would be pretty
sweet. My guess is something like that will happen someday. I mean, the fact is that there are many game things that are, game IPs that are being made into video games. Video games franchises IPs being made into movies now. There's like an Assassin's Creed movie, I think, in the works, and there's we just had the Warcraft movie, and there's the Naughty Dog one, Uncharted. I think that they have an Uncharted movie floating around out there. There's a bunch of them, rumors of a bunch of these movies being created. So I suspect at some point Diablo will make it. I don't know. I don't have any details on it, but
right.
Suspect someday it'll happen.
Yeah, I think there'll be a lot of people in line to see that. There's so many devoted fans to this franchise. The WoW movie. Did you actually see it?
I haven't seen it yet, and in fact, I keep meaning to see it. I didn't see it in the theaters. I don't really get to the theaters very often. I have been doing it a little bit more lately. You know, now that my kids are a little bit older, I'm able to get to the theater a little bit more often than I used to. And I have a friend of mine who lives a couple doors down from me, and he knows all these Hollywood people, and so we've been able to go see a bunch of movie premiere. I've been able to go see them with him. He invites me to these movie premieres.
Oh, that's cool.
And so that's been fun. We just went and saw the Fantastic Beasts on Monday.
How was it?
I was slightly disappointed. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't say slightly. I was disappointed. I am a massive Harry Potter fan. I've read each one of the books. I think the minimum that I've read a book is maybe 6 times. And I've read some of them like in the 10 to 15 range. And so I really love Harry Potter. I know Harry Potter back and forth. I've read the books to my kids, you know, it's to each one of them, all four, you know, so that there's four times at least. And I read them all myself. So the, I love Harry Potter. And so it felt like the Harry Potter world to me, but I didn't think that the characters were very likable. That was my personal opinion.
Man. All right, let's pause here and ask a couple more questions. Let's see, you've hyped up a lot of people. Oh, Everett's on. Hey, Everett. Let's see. So another one from Biomaster. If you ever do make a Diablo-like game again, Brevik, embody the gothic creepy feel because you're my dev idol because of Diablo 1 and Diablo 2. It's just so legendary. That's awesome.
Thank you. Absolutely. I definitely love this style and having a dark, creepy, scary atmosphere, I think, is important. I love that kind of style of game.
Yeah, you know, Marvel Heroes isn't that way. It's not dark and creepy or anything like that. But the way that game was designed, it fits really well with the ARPG style and the whole Marvel IP. But I think with Diablo, it's you got to have the creepy, dark nature in order to pull off, you know, this style. It's just a ton of fun. So there was a question about Marvel Heroes that I saw. Night Vision asks, what are your thoughts on the big changes being made to Marvel Heroes?
Well, I haven't given them a try yet. I think that it sounds great. I have no idea if it's going to be a good thing or not a good thing. It's impossible for me to comment on. The fact is that, you know, I'm not really part of the team. They can make the decisions that they want to make. And I think that if this is what they feel is going to make the game better, then more power to them. I think that I personally, you know, was happy with the way that we were going. But, with the gameplay and whatnot, But they, I think that they're making these changes for a lot of reasons, and I think that they're going to be happy with the way that it comes out.
So I got to be honest, what are the big changes that are being made? I'm not aware of it.
They're doing all sorts of changes. Like, all the characters are being completely revamped, and all their powers are being redone, and all their, you know, the almost every system in the game. They're, like, getting rid of they're not spells, but they're, you know, whatever their abilities, you know, mm-hmm. the ranks of those on items, so they're redoing the item game. They're redoing, things are going to be rarer, drop less often. They're going to have, everybody's got new skills. So they're pretty much redoing the entire game, from a playability, from a item drop standpoint. A lot of the stuff is going to get converted, so your gear isn't worthless, but they're making massive changes, that's for sure.
Do you know what the end goal is? Are they trying to make the game simpler? Less complicated?
I think that they're trying to streamline the entire process of being able to make characters and make it play better, and they just feel like, I think that this is something to keep not only the product fresh, but also an important step in making a better product into the future.
I see. All right, some more questions. Pause here. And let's see. So Pride of a Viking asks what your thoughts are on Grim Dawn, since Eric Sexton joined the game team.
I love Eric Sexton, but I haven't played it.
I think just hit version 1.0 a few months ago. It's like $30 or something on Steam. It's pretty good. I mean, I played it. I don't know if you care about my opinion, Private Viking, but
sure, absolutely.
I played it, and I actually kickstarted it, and however you're supposed to support it before the game comes out. Maybe it was just early access, but I really like it. I can't get past the first main chapter. It, for some reason, I play for an hour or so on that character, and then I just get sort of tired of it. And I don't know if it's a me thing. I actually had a conversation with a friend of mine who I think is on the stream right now watching, Grant. He and I play a ton of ARPGs, and David, you know Grant, or sorry, Brevik, you know Grant. he's, I can't kick the habit, but anyway, we just both felt like it's a game we should love, but we just don't, and we're not quite sure why. All right, let's see. Oh, pause. I feel like I'm going to die if I don't pause, especially since I can't hear anything. Let's see. Some of the stuff's a little bit older. So Leo's liking the changes to Marvel Heroes. That's cool. And, Everett's listing some of the changes that are coming. Looks like I'm pretty far behind here on my stream of the chat. Let's see. Didn't take Leo long to mention the Raccoonatics. We appreciate that. So, David, this is from the Eradicator. What do you see as the future of ARPGs? Is there anything different or new that hasn't been done yet that you'd like to see?
Oh, yeah. No, I think that there does need to be some changes to the ARPG genre. And there's a couple different directions that you can go. But, you know, I don't want to spell... I don't want to help everybody else with their designs, because I had a couple of those ideas I want to use myself. but, I think that there, you know, action RPGs in general need some new ideas and need some kind of freshness that separates them from some of their older things. There really hasn't been a whole bunch of innovation from even like the Diablo 2 times. Mm-hmm. A lot of stuff changes, it's slightly different, but I think that it's been a slow evolution. I think that there's some stuff that could be done to make it a lot more compelling for bigger groups, or for kind of fitting in with the way that people play games these days compared to the way that we did 15 years ago.
So what are you playing right now? What games?
I've been playing... I recently picked up the Overworld... I mean, Over... What's it? The
Overwatch?
No, not Overwatch. the trading game.
Off-World Trading Company.
Off-World Trading, yeah, exactly. Yeah. Off-World, and I played that a little bit, but mainly I'm playing WoW, because the new expansion brought me back, and so I've been playing a lot of that And then yesterday, Pokemon Sun and Moon came out, and so I've been pretty much nonstop on that for about 24 months now.
Have you been playing Pokemon since the Game Boy days?
Yes. Yeah. Okay, cool. I'm a huge Pokemon fan, and I have every version of I still have all the cartridges from every version. I've bought every version. I've played both sides of every version, and I've captured all the Pokemon. And so I've been playing. It's one of my favorite games. Probably one of maybe my favorite game. And so I played many hours. I even played a little bit of Pokemon Go, though I thought that it was a weak Pokemon game. But it was kind of interesting. I thought it was kind of gimmicky, but interesting. Didn't keep me long.
Right. So are there games that? Obviously, there's a lot of similarities between Diablo and Ultima and some other titles, but are there specific games that influenced you and your team on Diablo 2?
Where?
Yeah, I know I got lucky.
I think that there have been a bunch of games. There were a bunch of games that influenced Diablo and Diablo 2. And in kind of a weird way, Ultima was some of it, but Ultima was kind of the anti-version of what we wanted to make. Not that we, you know, Ultima's a bad game. It was just we wanted to kind of do the opposite. Ultima was a very much a traditional role-playing game where you asked a lot of questions and there was a lot of story and there was like slow advancement and you had a party sometimes and we wanted to kind of get away from that. We kind of wanted to make the fast, speedy version of role playing, rather than the kind of a largely story based game. Mm. And so that changed a lot because of that. We would say, well, what kind of do they do, and what do we like about Ultima? Well, we like the fighting, so why don't we make that really front and center, the part of what you're doing? And so, I think that doing things like even NHL hockey, playing the hockey games, the EA hockey games from the like NHL 94, taught us how to make quick menus. One of the things that we really liked about NHL is oftentimes it would be even when you're creating your old characters in an RPG, you would like decide on your look and your background. You'd answer all these questions. There'd be all these things or whatever. And it'd be like this hour-long process of creating your character. And we wanted to get in and start killing stuff right away. And so, that was from the NHL games. The NHL games, it's like you could get in, you could start body checking and skating around like with a couple button presses, and it's like three menus in, you're kicking butt. And so we wanted to kind of get away from the large, deep role-playing experience and get right into the action. And so it was kind of the opposite of what Ultima and that kind of games, the gold box games and things like that were doing at the time. And we wanted to go for something long, streamlined, and get you right into to killing stuff. And so I think that there wasn't really any other games out there that were like this at the time. So there wasn't really anything to draw that much inspiration from. However, obviously, it's highly inspired by the old roguelike games, including Rogue and Moria and Angband and other things like that. A lot of the ideas for the way that we went about making Diablo 1 were directly from those games. The kind of random levels, and there's some monster that you're after, 15 to 20 levels down into the dungeon, and mm-hmm. random items and all that kind of stuff were present in those kind of roguelike games.
Let's see if there's any other questions here. Oh my gosh, Leo's going crazy. I love it. Viomaster, lots of comments. There's a lot here. So Kenny asks, David, what are your thoughts on the new Sun and Moon changes for Pokemon?
So far I like it. I think that my favorite era of the Pokemon games is kind of past at this point. Like, I think that the Gold and Silver were, like, my favorites of the entire series. Now that they've gone to this kind of 3D version and you're much closer, you know, your character's much more of the screen and stuff, I think that they did that because you can relate to your character much better and whatnot, and there's a lot of cinematic experience to the combat and whatnot. I think it makes it a more modern game. But in a lot of ways, I liked the older style better. It was just quirky and weird and more Japanese. And it was just like, I mean, it just had a different flavor. And so I kind of, it makes me sound like an old curmudgeon at this point. But the back in my day, the Pokemon were much better. I like them Pokemans. I think that overall, I'm liking the game. I'm liking it better than I liked the last X and Y. I think that so far I'm enjoying it quite a bit.
Man, I'll be honest, I've never played Pokemon.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I had a Game Boy as a kid. I just never played it.
You have missed out.
Yeah. Well, I can go back, right? I mean, it's got to still be fun. I don't know. Can you jump into the new ones and still enjoy
Absolutely.
It?
Absolutely. Yeah? Yeah, there's no reason you can't jump into the new ones.
Yeah, maybe I'll try that. It's Kenny just got it, and he's pretty excited. That's the subject of our podcast tonight, actually, is going to be going back to play, getting newer handhelds late, or newer devices, period, late. We both jumped into the Xbox One a little late, not really in love with it. We talked about that last week, and now he just picked up a 3DS. So it's kind of late, but... Not too late.
It is kind of late. I mean, I've had my 3DS for a long time, but no time like the present. That's for sure. I mean, I think that Pokemon is an amazing game, I really love collecting the creatures and leveling them up and evolving them and having new abilities and capturing rare ones. And you know, I think that it's similar in a lot of ways to a Diablo type of game. It's turn based, so it's not as intense as this, but you know, it's kind of, it's definitely a role-playing game where you're leveling things up and you're capturing rare things. And, you know, I think that all kind of hits all the right buttons for me.
Yeah, and, you know, the rarity and items, that's everywhere now. It's just everywhere. You see legendary items. And did you play Destiny at all?
Destiny? I did. I only played a little bit, though. I only played to, like, level, I don't know, 20 or so, mm-hmm. something like that.
I mean, it's in there. It's in a lot of games now, and I'm curious, do you feel like that was, it's really a result of the work that you and your team did on Diablo, kind of bringing this game to so many people in such a digestible way?
Oh, I think that the gamification of every type, I mean, it seems like every genre now has a bit of role-playing in it. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like first-person shooters. Oh, we're going to have classes now, and we're going to, you know, and rare items and whatever. And, I don't know if it's directly because of us. I think it's just a natural evolution of the entire, of games in general. The fact is that finding rare things and that kind of gameplay, the slot machine style gameplay, mm-hmm. is addictive and fun and has been around, and there's no reason not to add it to almost any kind of game.
Yeah. It is beyond fun. And so I just started playing Battlefield 1, and there's a bunch of that in there too. You can find, you know, better items, but it's all about grinding and playing and playing and playing over and over again. And
well, that's not just because of the, you know, a designer's choice. It is also the choice of a company.
Sure.
The fact is that they want you, whatever game it is, it's so hard to capture people's mind share at this point. There's so many games out there, so much competition, that getting somebody to like stick to something and sink more money into it and things like that is something that they're always looking for. So having systems that encourage you to stick around for a while is, and people feel like they get their money's worth out of it better and things like that. So there's consumer advantage as well, but companies are doing this for a reason.
Absolutely. So we got some more questions. Kenny says that Pokemon does not play like Diablo 2, Kenny. That can't be right.
It doesn't. I mean, it's turn-based, so it's not. It doesn't, but it does in that there are similar things. You know, you're leveling up and you're choosing skills and you're just doing it with, you know, 100 alts, not with.
Don't reward him. Don't reward Kenny for a stupid comment. Just kidding, Kenny. So Kenny asks, why not bring a Diablo 2 type game to the Vita or the 3DS yourself, personally?
There's no reason I couldn't.
So what are you waiting for? Should we all be kickstarting a project?
No. I mean, I the things that I'm working on right now, I'm working on two projects right now. And one of them is it's a cell phone game. It's a role-playing game. I must be out of my damn mind for making a cell phone game. I mean, it's not like a typical cell phone game. I don't even know how to describe it. Like, I eventually have described it to a few people. I've talked about it with a few people. And it takes me about 20 minutes to even explain what the game is. I need an elevator pitch, and I don't have one for it. but anyway, I don't have a... it is a role-playing game for sure, and it is action-oriented, but it is not like Diablo. There is nothing out there like that. I don't even know how to describe it, really, so it's very weird. But I'm really enjoying playing, making that, and that's been my biggest focus. I'm also working on a role-playing game on the PC, but again, I'm doing this by myself. So there's nobody working on the products with me, which makes it kind of slow.
Yeah, but then you can get your vision completely out there, outsource where you need to or partner up where you need to. So it must be an exciting feeling.
I think it wasn't just that. I don't think it's about control really necessarily, but it's more about, I really wanted to get back to making games, right? What's happened with me and keeps happening with me and not, it's got advantages and disadvantages. I keep getting promoted to being the boss. and it's because I'm kind of good at it, right? And so they say, oh, Dave will do it. He did a good job last time. Why don't we make him do it again? And so which is very flattering, and oftentimes I'll do it. But I really wanted to get back to actually making some games. And I just needed a break from doing what I was doing. And I had this fantasy that I was going to make something in a few months. And for the most part, I did. But then the idea that I had was like, oh, this may take longer than a few months. And I really wanted to do something quickly. So why don't I do something else? And then that wasn't quick either. So I don't really know what the hell I'm doing at this point. I should probably hire a few people and make a real company. I mean, I've made a real company, but I should probably, hire a few people and make a team and get to releasing some of this stuff.
Well, I might be able to help you with that elevator pitch. That's kind of what I do. But that's more of a one-time project, so unfortunately. So let's try to get David back some time to his weekend and back to his kids and his family. Any other questions that you guys have for David? We'll let the stream run for another minute or two. See, Pride of a Viking. Was there any mechanic or idea you had in mind when creating Diablo 2 that was too ambitious at the time, but which you were able to incorporate in some way into Marvel Heroes?
Yeah. Absolutely. The thing that we wanted to do the most that didn't get done with Diablo 2, there are two things. One was that it was too gruesome. I'll tell you the two stories. One is that we had dropped body parts in Diablo 2 for a while. And that meant, like, when you killed creatures, you could collect elements from them, an eyeball, a tooth, horn, whatever, bone shard, all sorts of things like that. But they became really gruesome. So your entire inventory was like filled with these gruesome objects. And so we had, I think that people had, and it was a big fight internally. And in fact, we took them out, and it was really controversial, and there was like protests around the office. People were hanging signs on their doors saying, bring back the body parts. People were really upset. A lot of the development team was upset that we took them out. That was probably one of the most controversial things that we ended up taking out. And you could use these things to craft stuff and whatnot. It made a more elaborate crafting game. But anyway, eventually we removed those. So that was one thing that maybe we should have, maybe we shouldn't have removed. Who knows? Hmm. I mean, it's hard to argue with the results. I mean, Diablo 2 is a very beloved game at this point. Hmm. So it's, who knows what it would have been like with a bunch of gruesome objects all over the place. That was one thing. And then the second thing is that technically there was one thing that we couldn't do, and that was make Battle.net Town. One of the things that we had talked about is that rather than setting you into a chat room our dream was to make this thing called Battle.net Town, rather than coming into a chat room in Battle.net, you actually went into a graphic town. And you walked around and you interacted with people and you chatted, and you would have like a chat window as part of the town, but you also kind of walked around and you could visit vendors and do things like that with your character and show your character off and whatnot. And so that was what we were working on. We had it almost all ready and working, but in the end, we had to cut it due to time. We just didn't have the time. The project was already, quote unquote, late. We wanted to release it for Christmas in 1999, and then we delayed it 6 months and it came out end of June 29th, I think, in 2000. We were already 6 months late, and we canceled the Battle.net Town plans probably in January or February, and just realized it was just going to be too much extra work, and we didn't have enough time to do it all.
Wow. I can't imagine this game. It feels like it'd be fundamentally different if that were an option for multiplayer.
Yeah. It was just going to give you a more immersive experience. Like, what was one of the goals that we had with Diablo 2 compared to Diablo 1? Diablo 2, like Diablo 1, you had loading screens between, and loading screens used to be a big nightmare because drives were slow and there was a lot of stuff, and it would take forever to load a level. And so we wanted to, in Diablo 2, I thought about it a lot, and I was like, hey, I got an idea on how we can actually kind of stream the entire level and remove loading screens altogether. And so we wanted to kind of make a more immersive experience in general we wanted so that you enter the world, you never really left that world. And so that was one of the reasons that we came up with this idea for Battle.net Town, to make it a more immersive experience.
Oh, that's awesome. So, okay, let's see. A couple more questions for you, Brevik. Let's see, it's from Biomaster. Pause. Okay, last question. Do you think the big mistake that games make nowadays is they think more color shades take away from the feel? I remember the mortem, must be the post-mortem that you posted a few months ago. Explain how you, how you limited the color shading to create a feel. So talk to us about color shading.
Yes, that's correct. We use lighting and shading and the actual colors that we... The colors that we chose are kind of saturated. They're gray, grayish, more gray color. And that added to the kind of the atmosphere and look to the game for Diablo 1 and 2. And so I think that the actual lighting, which was something that really had not been done. Like when you went into the dungeon in most games, it wasn't dark like Diablo 1 was. When you came in, the monsters came out of the dark. It was frightening, and so we wanted to kind of capture that spirit and make that still part of Diablo 2 as well as Diablo. I mean, it was, I thought, an important part of Diablo 1. We included it in Diablo 2. In Diablo 2, there's actually time of day, like it'll get night and it'll be dark and you'll have kind of the radius around you, but during the day, it's much brighter and you can see outdoors. So, it was only kind of indoors in Diablo 1. I mean, you went outdoors to go to town, but it was mainly indoors, so it was dark all the time. In Diablo 2, there was kind of indoors and outdoors, but even outdoors, it would get dark. And so I thought that the lighting in that was part of the gameplay and part of the reason that that it created the atmosphere that it did. Plus, actually, the very muted kind of colors like that accentuated the entire thing, made it more of kind of a realistic look to the world rather than kind of a fantasy look. It has a more real world location look to it.
So one last question. Sorry, folks, we want to give David back some of his time. This one's from the Eradicator. Some ARPGs struggle to find the right type of endgame content to keep people around long term. What do you think makes a successful ARPG endgame?
Focusing on items. Just plain and simple.
Mm-hmm.
What keeps people playing RPGs is people having new challenges and being able to, you know, get items, improve their character, and be cooler, you know, yeah. feel more powerful, and take on those harder challenges, the hardest challenges in the game. That's what keeps people around, and you know, and so that's, I think, that items, and especially with an action RPG, the rarity of items, finding those items that you're searching for, can keep you playing for a long time to overcome kind of the ultimate challenges in the game.
Awesome. Thank you, David. I have one last question for you.
Sure.
The way I've been playing, weird or expected?
No, you seem to be playing like a lot of people. I mean, you're not playing like I see some of the speedrunners playing.
I haven't played in, like, you know, really played in 10 years.
Like, you look like you're playing just fine. I mean, that's kind of the pace and the way that I play. You were playing the way that I kind of casually go about killing a bunch of the stuff and slowly, you know, getting better and saving some of my items and doing the same things that I think a lot of people do.
Yeah, I also like to work my way around the map and kind of fill it all in.
Yep. That's a very, very common thing. And when I play with my wife, she insists that we fill out every
map. You got to play it right, and there's a lot of right ways to play it. Thanks, David, for joining. We really appreciate it.
Yeah, no problem at all. Thanks for the invite. It was fun.
Yeah, absolutely. So, folks, this is the first interview in a series that I'm trying to do with irregularity. This won't be every Saturday at 1. It's just going to be various times. But the next stream, I believe, will be tomorrow at 5 p.m. Pacific time with Warren Smith, who's making a game called Dark Flame, which is a Castlevania-inspired 2D side-scroller. And you can Google it. I think he has an Indiegogo out there, and he's doing pretty well. I've played an early build of the game. It's a ton of fun. You can read the review or the preview on thegww.com, and that's for the geeks worldwide. And then in the coming weeks after Thanksgiving, I'm going to do a stream with Brad Wardell, the CEO of Stardock. We're going to play their new game, which is Ashes of the Singularity Escalation, a new standalone expansion for that game. It's a 4X. Oh, God, I'm so bad at RTSs, but we're going to play it, so good luck to me. So we appreciate everybody taking the time to join us today. Thanks so much, Brevik, Mr. B, David, the man, the father of Diablo. Thank you so much.
My pleasure. Thank you.
All right. Take care.